Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining me again in this lesson number 73, where we continue our discussion about reflection, and today we'll focus mainly on using annotations. Of course, you have already seen annotations in the previous couple of lessons that I have recorded, because this is basically the third lesson where we discuss Java reflection. But today we'll mainly focus on the syntaxes for annotations, and of course we'll use them again once more with Java reflection, and I will try to also answer a question from one of you who asked me this week about the implementation of a specific functionality that copies an instance into another kind of an object, if we can do something like this using reflection. And the answer is yes, we can. And it basically, the question fits very well with what we wanted to do today, annotations. And as well, it's good to know, because it's one of the things that will open your eyes on how specific frameworks create instances that they manage. So for example, in case of a framework that works with a database, like take for example Hibernate or another JPA implementation, when Hibernate selects some data from the database, it out of the box somehow creates some instances of those so-called entities, and then it puts them into the context and it manages it there. So the question is, how can Hibernate or any other similar framework create those instances? Because that's very similar with basically what we could implement today, just copying the data from one instance to another. The same is when you create an instance but you take the data from somewhere else, like a database. So it can give you a little bit more details on how, again, the inside of a framework works, which is a very good fundamentals. And that's why I want to still keep this into the fundamental stream, and we'll discuss it today. So, of course, by the way, you have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions in the live chat. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for your messages. And if you don't see the event now, you will find it recorded, and you can still ask questions in the comment section, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter. But for now, let me already share my screen. So you can see here, I have already created a project for our lesson 73, and it's simply an empty project. I only have the JDK, the latest version 15. And first of all, I'd like to discuss syntaxes on annotations. And then once we have seen the most relevant syntaxes on annotations, we will go into our exercise. So let's see. So let me first create a package here. And let's just go with my annotation, because it's for the moment irrelevant. I don't want you to focus on a specific functionality for this annotation that we will create now. I want you only to focus on the syntax itself. So I want you first to know all the possible syntaxes that you can use when writing an annotation, and I see you have some problems, but please confirm me if you can still hear me, because from my side everything looks okay. I'm not sure if it's a problem or not. So yeah, I will just continue. And again, I was creating this annotation and I was just trying to tell you, first of all, to focus on the syntax for the annotation. So I don't want you to focus on a specific functionality. And remember that when you create an annotation, you basically use the interface keyword and you prefix it with this @. Now this is something we've already used, and you know that I can already use it as an annotation. And first of all, the main important thing, that again is something you will find also in the previous couple of lessons, is that we have two important annotations that you use over the annotations. And the most important one from my point of view is the retention policy. So the retention annotation that sets the retention policy, where you have the possibility to specify a runtime class or source. Remember, class is the default, but it's pretty rarely used. Runtime is what you'll very often see, because this is what you need to set for any annotation that you wish to use with Java Reflection. That's what we've done also in the previous couple of lessons. And source is a kind of an annotation that's only available on the source code before the compilation, and that the compiler erases once the code is transformed from the Java file to the class file. So when it's bytecode, the annotation simply disappears. That's why if you set this retention policy or the class one, then Reflection won't be able to use your annotation. But source annotations, they are pretty often actually. For example, the override annotation, it's only used by the compiler. It doesn't exist after compilation. That's a source annotation. Suppress warnings is another good example. All the annotations that are part of the Lombok dependency, we will discuss later about Lombok dependency. Then all of these basically, which are only needed on the source code, they are source annotations. But if, and we would like, of course, to use annotations pretty often at the runtime, then you really need to set the retention runtime, something you really don't need to forget, because otherwise you will see the annotation is not seen because it's not there. So don't worry about the microservices. I have already scheduled, starting in February, a stream only on software architectures, and that will also cover microservices. So I hope this answers your question. Just take a look. I have already scheduled the first lesson in February, so very soon it will start. The second annotation that's important is the target one, because by default you use annotations, you can use annotations on any kind of language element. But usually when you write an annotation, it's only dedicated to one or maybe a couple or three elements. You don't create annotations that are usable on absolutely any element of your app. You either use it on parameters, either use it on classes, maybe use it on the class or on the constructor, maybe use it on the field and then on the method, but it's very rarely that you want to use an annotation absolutely everywhere. So using the target annotation, you restrict the elements to which you want your annotation to apply. So for example, if you'd like to make this annotation usable only on fields and on methods, then you simply here specify the target. I want it to be only on field and on methods. And if I did this now, I specify the target, you can simply prove, and I will prove it, I will create an example one class to prove it. If I have a field string x and the method void m string, of course in this case you will see that my annotation is usable on both the method and the attribute. So you see it's compiling. Yeah, I have no problem with it being used on either line 5 or line 8. But if I would try to go above the class and use it here on the class, my annotation, so you can try to do that, but you will basically see that on the class is not accepted. Now IntelliJ underlines it with red. This is a compilation error. If you try to compile it now, it won't work. So you either use it on the targets, or you can't use it at all, because if you try to use it on something else, a parameter, a constructor, an exception thrown, whatever, if you try to use it anywhere else than the targets, then it won't work. Okay, so let's comment it out here, saying this doesn't work here. And it doesn't work here because it's not among the targets, the class is not among the targets. And this is the first thing I consider very important to know, that gives you the opportunity of declaring your empty annotation. So having an empty annotation and being able to use it with reflection and runtime and being able to specify some targets is a start. Of course, you will say we already know that because you showed that also in the previous couple of lessons. So let's continue and discuss a little bit more on what other things you can use on your annotation. So first of all, your annotation might have what we call properties. We say they are properties, but the syntax we use to declare them is the same syntax we used for methods. Because see, you are still inside of a structure that mainly looks like an interface. So the way you will declare here the properties, it's same as you are doing when you use when you declare abstract methods in your interface. So say for example string x, string let's just say something about it, x, or we can give it a name. Let's say xyz is not that relevant, but what's relevant to remember is that the name you give to the method, even though it looks like a method, this is not a method, this is simply a property of your annotation. So even though it looks like a method and you declare this round parenthesis after the XYZ, because if you don't do that, you will have a compilation problem. This is only the name, not of a method, but of a property. And this is the type of that specific property. And if you don't write anything else, then this property becomes mandatory. What's mandatory is, of course, you need to specify the property, because if you don't specify the property, then you will have a problem with using the annotation. So see here, I already have a warning from my IntelliJ saying that now I have two related problems with my annotation. And the related problems, they came immediately after adding this line 12, so the property, because if I only declare the property the way you see it here, it becomes mandatory. So now in example one, the both places where I use my annotation are giving me a compilation problem. And that's of course because I need now also to provide a value for the property XYZ. So now I need to say something like XYZ is, and then provide whatever value I want for XYZ. Okay, so I need to provide that value. And this is how properties of annotations, because I'm pretty sure you might have seen annotations up to now. I'm sure many of you are not only watched my fundamental stream, you may maybe also have seen the Spring Security stream and the Spring Framework and the Hibernate JPA, and you've seen that annotations very often are not simply a name prefix with the at symbol. They might also have properties, as I'm doing here. And maybe you're wondering, how can we add a property to an annotation that we customly create? So if I create a custom annotation, how can I add a property? And now you know. But if I add it like this, now my problem disappeared because of course I have added on both places a value for the property. But you see that if I add the property simply as is, then it's mandatory for me that I provide a value. So if I simply try to erase it, this becomes a compilation error. By default, any annotation property is mandatory. You need to provide a value for it. What if I would like to make it optional? Can I have properties that I don't necessarily need to define annotations? And again, you probably might know already the answer for this, because again, if you'd used any kind of annotation from any kind of framework, you might have seen that you don't necessarily only use annotations, you use different attributes, and sometimes you have attributes you need to use, and in other cases you simply skip them. So there has to be a way in which attributes can be used as optional. And there is actually a way, and the way is defining that specific property with a default value. And you can do that by using the default keyword, which you know from both the switch conditional you use a default case on a switch when you want to have a default value for a switch for any other case of a switch. You also use this keyword, if you remember, in an interface for starting with Java 8 to define methods that have an implementation. So if you remember 6 years ago, starting with Java 8, or maybe 7 years ago, starting with Java 8, you can write in an interface methods that have implementations. So you use the default keyword for that. And now you've learned another keyword, another place where you can use the same keyword. The default keyword is the same one you can use to give a default value for a property of an annotation. So if you go back here, you will see that my compilation problem disappeared on line 9, because in this case, on line 9 now, even though I don't define the property, now when I don't do that, it will take the default value. So as long as your property has a default value, it's not mandatory for it anymore, so it becomes optional. So when you have a property that is optional, then if it has a default value, then it becomes optional. It's not mandatory anymore to give it a value. You can use the default value, and that happens automatically when you don't specify a value, or you can overwrite that value, as you can see here on line 6, and then the value will be the new one, whatever you want to specify here. So it will be the one you specify yourself when declaring the property on the annotation. So you can have any kind of an object for an annotation property value, but mind that you can't have collections. You might only use arrays in case you need more elements. So that syntax, that nice syntax with curly braces, is usable only by defining arrays. So you can't have you might have basic properties like integers, wrapper classes, strings, but you can't actually have any kind of object. So I might have said something I might have said can instead of can't earlier, sorry for that. The idea is you can't use any kind of object in annotations. So let me show you. If I'm here trying, for example, to use a list and say list lists, and try to use this list, which is say just the interface, the Java util list, you will see that it should tell me here that's not something I can use on an annotation. But if I would say want to create a list of strings, instead of a list of strings, you can replace that by an array. So you can use an array of strings instead of the list of strings. And you can also give it a default if you'd like. And then the syntax for the array is just, if you say you want an empty array, then you just use the curly braces for that. If you want to have any element inside, then you might simply declare it as any other array with the curly braces syntax for the array. So it's pretty easy, it's not something very difficult. The idea is you might have strings and you might have simple properties like integers and values in general, and you can have arrays, but that's it for, that's basically it. You can also have annotations as well. But that's basically it. So you can't have any kind of an object here. You must be careful when thinking about that annotation property, because you only can have simple values here, not any kind of a value. Okay, but that basically says most of the things you need to know about an annotation. There is only one more thing you might need to know, and that's the fact that in case of an annotation, you can have a property named value. If you have a property that's named value, no matter if the value is or not mandatory, So if it's optional or mandatory, it doesn't really matter. The idea is that when the property is named value, is basically the only property for which you don't have to provide the name in front of it, because you also might have seen cases, or if you didn't see them yet, you might see them further, cases in which you find out annotations being used without the name of the property in front of a value. And maybe you're asking yourself, why and how is that possible? And the answer is pretty simple. When you see something like this, it means that the annotation declares a property named value, and for this property named value, and only for this property, is not mandatory that you provide the name of the property. Of course, that's only in the case you only use that property. So if I want to declare both of them, now I cannot simply just go and say, and I want XYZ to be something else. So automatically IntelliJ placed then the value equal in front of the value. So you can use value only with its value if it is the only property you define for the annotation. But once you want to enumerate more of them, then you mandatory have to enumerate them, and they will always have name of the property equal value you provide for the property. So you can't use some other syntax for that. It's mandatory you use both the name and the value for any property of the annotation. And theoretically, with this being said, you should now have no problems with understanding any annotation, any syntax for any annotation that you might see and use with specific frameworks that I'm sure you will use in your implementation. So these are basically all the things you will find with annotations in Java. So these are the things you will find with any kind of an annotation you might use. Usually you of course can define your own annotations as we are doing here, but usually when you use them, I expect that you mainly in your work you will use annotations that already exist, annotations that are part of specific frameworks that you use in your application, like Spring, Jakarta IE implementations, JPA implementations like Hibernate, and any other framework you would use. And now, that being said, say we have proved the way in which you can implement any annotation with Java, with all the syntaxes, all the relevant syntaxes. The next thing I would like to discuss with you is related to the question that we can implement with Reflection. Can we copy an instance into another instance, maybe of the same type or maybe of another type, using Java Reflection? Let's try to do this, and let's try to link this demonstration with some relevant things where different frameworks such as Hibernate use the same concept behind. Thank you very much for your appreciations. I'm going to create another package so that's easy for you then to remember where we added the example. Let me create a package example here. And in the package example, let's create a class cat. So say this is my class cat. And the cat has a name, so it's just private string name. And yeah, we can just leave it like this. If we want also to see the name, maybe it's easier for us if we also at least create a getter for it. And we'll also want to set a name, so maybe a setter is also it's also good. So let's create actually a getter and a setter. We'll have a simply encapsulated class this way, so only an attribute, because it's enough for our demonstration. And the getter and the setter for that attribute. And I will basically just copy the same class as you see it here, and I will name it dog. And then I will create a class example 2. And in the second example class, the statement of the problem is we have a cat. Cat C is new cat. And we want to implement a functionality that copies the instance into another instance of a given type, which can be cat or can be any other type. So in my case, I would like to even be able to copy it in a dog. So how can we do something like this? Well, let's try to separate a little bit the functionality here and create a separate method for our implementation. And in this separate method that we want to define, we will take as arguments the instance we'd like to be copied and the type in which we want to copy that instance. So can we do something like this? I think we should be able. So private static, then the type, we need to know which is the type we want to copy. Say we declare a generic type because we don't know the type, I think, yet in this case. So say private static type T copy instance. Let's name it copy instance. And then we just get an object. This object is the instance we want to copy. And then we need a class of T, which should be the type in which we would like to copy that instance. So something like this. Let me add a return null here just for the moment to see how can I call it now. I should be able to say dog D is copy instance of C, the cat, the instance I'd like to copy, and then dog class, which is the type of object I'd like to copy into, to transform my instance into. And then basically I can say something like D get name. And we expect that if we print this out in the console, our functionality should print out Tom here. So if we succeed, then the instance I, which is initially of a type cat here, that's an object in my case, but basically, if you really want, you could make it a generic as well here. I think it's not that relevant. Here I use the generic because I need to be sure that whatever I return here is precisely the type of the class that I have used here, that the user sent me here as a second parameter. So this type, this generic type for the response, is, I would consider it a little bit more mandatory. But you could use a generic type as well here if you'd like, if it feels more comfortable for you to use something else instead of object. Now, how can we do that? Let me think a bit. So what I want to do is creating first an instance of C. And the way in which we know we can create an instance of C is, first of all, get the declared constructor. And we'll basically do this the same way any kind of framework in general assumes. Usually the frameworks assume you have a default constructor. It's not always the case, but we'll take the simple scenario. We will consider we have a default constructor. For example, Hibernate and any JPA implementation generally does that. It assumes you have a default constructor in that class and it uses the default constructor of the class. Did you ever try, if you ever tried to use Hibernate or JP implementation and you maybe forgot, you declared the constructor in your entity and you forgot to also declare yourself the empty parameters constructor, which has a signature equivalent to the default one? You might have seen you get you got an error when the JPA implementation tried to create an instance. So when you selected something from the database, the reason you got an exception in case you've run into such a problem is because Hibernate and the JPA implementation by default, like I do in this case, it tries to find a constructor without the parameters. Usually, if you didn't declare a constructor, then we know that by the Java syntax, the class will have a default constructor without parameters, which is the default constructor. If not, you have to declare it yourself. But in my case here, I can simply say constructor, which is the result constructor, and I just get the declared constructor here. Of course, we will have plenty of exceptions, so to avoid focusing on the exceptions for the moment, just let's put them out, throwing them out of the method because they are irrelevant for us. And in this case, the constructor will be of the type T, which is the type we want to return, so that in my case I will get the result, and the result is an instance of type T, and the instance of type T should be created by using the new instance method of the constructor by reflection. So in the end, this is what I will return. And now I have, in my case, assuming this call here on line 11, and the fact that I provided as a second parameter dog class, this is dog, this is a constructor of the class dog, so this result here is basically an instance of dog in this case. But of course, if you would have provided here cat, then it would have created a cat instance. And if you have a different other class, whatever class you want to provide, it will create an instance of that specific class, assuming again that you have a NoArgs constructor, because that's what I assumed when I called this method here without parameters. I assumed I have the NoArgs constructor, otherwise my code would fail with an exception. That's what happens again also in a framework when it assumes that. So we have the result, and then what we need to do is take also the class of the input. So let me say class input class is I get class, and I get a class of the input. And then why do I need to get a class of the input? Because I want then further to get all the fields, because that was the problem scenario. It was copy all the fields from one type to another, from an input instance to another input instance. So that's what I want to do in the end. So I have the result, and I have to populate it, and in order to populate it, then I have to take the class of the instance I got as an input, so the instance from where I copy the values. So I say input class get declared fields, and I take all the fields of that specific type, and that's something you have seen also in the previous lessons. You know that in Java Reflection we have classes that we use to refer to class, to an object, to the constructor, to fields, to methods. Of course, you need to write it correctly. And now I will simply just use a for loop to parse through this array, which are the fields of the class of my input instance. So in my case, they are the fields of the cat class, because here as the first parameter I have delivered C. So I say for, and I simply try to parse all the fields. And because I know that they might be private, and that's again something very realistic, because in a real world scenario you usually make them private, When you write your entities with JPA or you write your parameters for the Spring application, you do write them private, and still Spring or Hibernate or whatever framework you use is able to populate them. And that's because, as we discussed in the previous couple of lessons, reflection is very powerful. And with one small exception of a modular application in Java, it can even bypass the access mode, so it can bypass the fact that your field in this case is private. But to do that, you have to use the setAccessible method, and this is to bypass the fact that the field might be private. It is private in our case. And what I do need to do now is I take every field from the input, and I try to match it with a field on the output class, which is this class C here. So now I need to say C get declared fields, so the fields of the output class. And again, take them output fields, and I took all the output fields, and I have to search through the output fields. Maybe this is not the best approach performance wise, but I don't want to complicate you now with performance optimizations. I would like you only to focus on the algorithm and on the solution. So that's why I will basically do a 4 inside a 4, which is an n squared complexity, which you might say maybe we have a better solution. And I'm actually certain we might have a better solution, like, for example, at least by sorting the fields. But again, let's focus on the implementation and not on optimizing it, at least for now. So I took all the fields on the input. I make them accessible, and then I take all the fields, say var output, which is the output fields, and then I make it again accessible because it's the same thing on the output. It might be private, so I need to be sure that it's accessible. I can't just rely on the fact that it's not private. Yeah, exactly. This is precisely how a DTO entity mapper work, and that's actually the question I got. So somebody, I'm not sure who, but you might be here watching me now, but or you might see me afterwards recorded. But somebody asked me this week about how these mappers work. How can you copy from one instance to another? And this is a very good question, not only because of understanding mappers, but the fact that this logic is behind in many cases. So even when, again, I was saying also earlier, when you have Hibernate, Hibernate creates issues a select to the database, it selects some data, and then the selected data, which is initially a result set, a JDBC result set, how does Hibernate link the result set to a specific entity? It's precisely the same thing. It's maybe not precisely the same thing. It doesn't copy from one instance to another. It just creates an instance and populates it from the result set. So it's just copying the data from a result set to an instance, which is more or less the same thing I'm doing here. So not only DTO to entity mappers work like this, but the same logic you find in many other situations behind the scenes in a specific functionality that you use. And it's very nice to understand what's behind that functionality. And that's what I'm trying to prove here by, first of all, answering to the question, and secondly, by proving how it works, and that should create a very good understanding for what I'm doing here. So now I'm doing the same thing, and what I'm actually trying to do here is say if FO, which is the output field, get name, the name of the output field is exactly the name of the input field, then in the output field set the value of the input field of instance I, and I'm not sure when I do set, so I do set for the field, and then of course, yes, and then of course I have to say for the result, which is the instance in which I copy. So I copy the value, I get the value from the input and I copy it into the field of the output. So in this case, I only rely on the name. I know that name is the same here as it is here. And then I will show you, once we prove this is working, hopefully it will be working, then I will show you how you can use annotations for cases in which, for example, you might assume the name might not be the same. And that's again something often that you often find in frameworks, framework implementations such as Spring or Hibernate or any other framework, Java framework. So being this, being I did this, I can actually already try to run it. Let me try to run it. I just started and I expect it will build my app now and it will run my app. And if we didn't do anything wrong, then you will see in the output the name Tom. And there is one more thing. You see here that I get a dog and I print out from the dog, but I have provided a cat. So it should be enough to prove that indeed the functionality is working. If you want, I can also print the get class, but it's pretty clear here that D is a dog because that's how I declared it on line 12. So it can't be something else as long as I declared it and there is no relationship, no inheritance between the two classes. So I have a problem, which means it's something that might have not correctly implemented. Let me see. It says cannot set, I want to see the full exception, cannot set a string field to string. That's interesting. So cannot set string field example doc name to string. That's quite interesting because both of them are strings, so it shouldn't have been a problem in this case. I cannot set the javalang string field example doc name to javalang string. That's something which looks a little bit odd from my point of view, but we can try to debug it to see. So we should take into account the type of the, yes, we should take into account, but this here it's a little bit strange because it's anyway the same type, because I wanted to simplify the example. So we see both of them are strings and still issues me a problem. Indeed, what you say is here, I should say, and necessarily FO get type should be the same with, maybe a equals is better here, with F get type, which is the input. So this is indeed something we need to take into consideration, but it's still not clear for me why I get the exception, at least for now here, because I knew that anyway they were both of them string, and that was my plan from the very beginning, just because I wanted to, yeah, actually simplify the example. I don't want to overcomplicate the syntax here. That's not the purpose of my example. I want you to understand what's happening, but in a simple way, not write very complex code for nothing. And you see it's still doing the same thing, which is a little bit odd. Which is a little bit odd because both of them are strings. But we can try to debug it. And anyway, if it's still not working, I will try to find what my problem is later and tell you. But it's anyway, the idea is the same, so it doesn't really matter now precisely the problem. The idea should be the same. So let's actually see. I'm actually curious what happens here, because it shouldn't be any problem. So I have the name from the F. It says F get name, and this one should be name. This one should actually be name. So I say evaluate expression, and this should be name, which is okay, which is expected. So that's what I expect. And I expect that f get name is the same, because it's the only field anyway here and there, so it shouldn't be any problem. It's still name. And then the type should be as well the same, because I managed to get it here, but somehow for some reason it seems that on this line it can't copy the value of string in the result. And if I evaluate the get here, I get Tom, which is right, but again for some reason it seems that the set on the output is not working, even though the output is still a string. This is kind of strange. No, it's not needed, because the equal ignore case is not needed, because in my case I really wanted to simply compare them, and they are anyway, they have the same name. It's just a problem here, because yes, I know what the problem mix actually. Now I remember that I think we should have specific methods, set methods, and we should have basically check against the type and then set it. I'm not sure if that's the case here. So I see I have specific methods actually for everything besides the object type. And still strange from my point of view, but what I will do is say something like this. If it is a string, I should basically try to test it like this. So if it is a string class, then I will take the value as a string and try to set it this way. And I'm not sure if this is the problem, but I remember to have seen this in a code somewhere in an open source framework at some point many years ago. So maybe it was a really so it has the package. No, it's okay. Get name should be okay. It should really be okay. So the problem is basically, so string input will be, in this case, just to make sure I see it, I get it from I, which is the input, and then of course in this case I have to make sure I cast it, because it can be any object, and then I will have to set the input as well here. And I will still try it like this. And again, I think I've seen something like this, but it's not really clear for me. Now, still have a problem with it. I wonder if I would actually have the same problem if I just chose an integer. I know that's not really plausible to put an integer here, but I can just try it for the test. And I will try to find out later why string gave me a problem here. Probably it's a good reason why, but it seems that's something that I clearly don't know. But again, the idea is the same, so you don't have to be discouraged by this exception here. The idea is the same. This is syntactically something I'm doing wrong. It's not in what concerns the idea. Let me try with the integer to see if it's the same problem. Then I will just leave it, because I don't want to take your time. I will just leave it, and then I will tell you if I find the problem later. I will let you know in the next lesson what the problem was. But again, I'm pretty sure the idea is the same, because I've been dealing with this. So in my case now, I can actually just say, set it like this. It's accessible. Yeah, I'm not sure precisely again why. Say this is the age, not the name. Just imagine it like this. Now it still has a problem, so it doesn't really matter what kind of object I try to set here, it still has a problem. So it might be something I need to do more than just specifying the value, and it might be something that it's not even have been there from the very beginning. I will try one more thing to do. So I will just reset int and get int here, and just to try to make it work, because I would like to show you that annotation stuff as well. And now, of course, in the result, so maybe I'm not doing something, so I think I just realized what I'm doing wrong here, did I? So I should have used set and specified precisely the object in which I was putting it. But result is my object, isn't it? Because I think it's trying to set it in the rest, not in the field. Very strange. Being that here I see it's actually expecting an int now. So I can expect, it actually expects me precisely to give it the value of the field, but that doesn't actually make any sense. Oh, I think I just have realized what I'm doing wrong. So second is the first is the, such a stupid mistake. Sorry for that. So it's just me being too dumb tonight. So it's just the first parameter was the object. The second one was the value. I wasn't doing anything. Basically, I was wrong, but I wasn't that wrong at all in the end. So let me actually go back and try change back the classes to how they were, name. And next time I will have to be more careful with the order of my parameters. It seems that I sometimes really do the most stupid mistakes. I still do the most stupid mistakes after many years of programming, and still do the most stupid mistakes sometimes. So it happens to me once in a while. So now let me go back, because it was only the order of the parameters I was actually doing wrong in my example. So back to Tom here, and now it was okay. The type was fine. We will leave the type here. So the idea from you on is really good, because indeed you need to check the type, eventually throw an exception if the type is not right. And now I would just say in the object. So again, let me check again. So it's first is the object and then the value. So first the object, which is in my case the output, and then it is the value, which is in my case f get for from the input, and the input is I. Yeah, I'm not sure what to say. We will know about this in the future. Most probably I will forget it, because it's not that relevant for me, the order of the parameters for the set method. So I'm pretty sure that if you ask me to just redo the same example in a month from now on, I might do the same mistake, because again, it's very difficult to me to simply remember all the these things. So I might skip the same way to observe the fact that the order of the parameters is this one. But now it's good that we actually managed to see what the problem was, and let's see if now it's working. And now it is working, it did finally. So we got this Tom. Excellent. So that means we managed to copy a cat into a dog, and I still have a couple of minutes left. And remember that we were still discussing also annotations in this example. So what I want to do is try to prove you also how those annotations you sometimes use to specify a name. So let me just create an annotation of myself here. I will call it object attribute. Object attribute. And what I will do, I will just, of course, this is an annotation, so at interface, and I want to use it with reflection. So what I have to do is make sure I have the proper retention type, retention policy Yes, retention policy, come on. Runtime. I don't know what happens with my system again. I can skip the value. You know now why I can skip the value, because if the name of the attribute of the annotation is value, then you can skip it. Then we have target. And the target in my case will be field, because I want to use this on field. And then I will simply say string name, and I will make sure this one has no value, or simply just make it a default null. Null is not working, sorry, empty string. You can't, that's one more rule I forgot to say in the beginning of the lesson. You can't use null as a default, but you can use in this case the empty string. And now the idea is, what happens if the dog has an attribute that's not called name, it's called something else, like dog name. Yeah, it's stupid to have a field named dog name inside a class named dog, but just for my purpose of demonstration here, I want to make sure I have different fields. So here is name, here is dog name. So what happens, of course, if I'm going back, is definitely now you won't have this result anymore. So if I'm rerunning the application that previously was working, it should now just put a null into the console probably. And the reason we have a null in the console is because the names don't match anymore. So in my case, what happens is that my equals method will always return a false here. So the name, where I match the name here on line 31, so it's null indeed, because here on line 31 the name will never match, just because the cat has a field that's called name, but the dog has a field that's called something else. So how can we do in such, how can we adapt our functionality in this case to work, like still be able to copy data from one instance to another by somehow else having a solution for specifying the name? Well, what you will see is that in this case, in such cases, what frameworks do is implementing specific annotations. And they use these specific annotations to allow you provide a specific name. Like I will do in my case, I have created my add object attribute, and then I use it add object attribute name, and I say this is the equivalent of the field name. And where you find some logic like this, you find it in Hibernate, for example, with the @table annotation, or @column, where you use @table and @column, for example, to specify different names, because by default Hibernate will just try to find them by the real table name in the database, or column name. But if you have fields that are not called the same way, then you use table or column. You find this with JSON, which is a known dependency you use for JSON interpretation, where you use different annotations to specify the name of your JSON node, or XML. When you have XML parsing the same, you have to define if the XML tag is different from the field, you have to specify it. So the same feature we can implement in our case here. We just have to specify using an annotation if we have a different name. So how can we do that? How can we achieve this? We just have to change a little bit our algorithm to say here, I will just cut it out from here. I'll say extract it into a method. And of course, is equals is not the greatest name I can give to my method, and say just matches, or something like this would be much better. So I really don't know what happened here. Just I just wanted to take some refactor out the method again. Yeah, I'm not sure what happens with my IntelliJ. It's now some kind of a poltergeist. I just wanted to say here. So is equals, I would say, matches. Okay, excellent, matches. Oh, this is kind of a new feature or something, because I was used to giving me a pop-up where I just put the name of the method, and now I realized that it basically was expecting my name of the method here. Anyway, so this matches here, which won't be any longer just based on the name. So the two fields will match based on the name, or, and then I just have to, if the name is not the same, or maybe even better than this, I can first of all try by the annotation and then by the name and say F first of all if, because I'm not sure if F is annotated, is it? So, and it's not F, is FO, the output is annotation present object attribute. So I say if object attribute is present, I can just put it here like this. And then if the annotation is present, then it means I can get the annotation. So I will just say object attribute A is from FO get annotation object attribute. So I get the annotation if it's present. Then if it's not present, so if it goes on the else side, it will just return them by the name. But if it's present, if the annotation is present, then I will say return A name, which is the property from the annotation, equals F get name. And this way, now my matches method, which takes care of finding out where to set a value of a specific attribute, will first of all check if an annotation object attribute is present. If the annotation is not present, it will try to make a match on the name. And if the name doesn't correspond, then it will simply return a false. If an annotation is present, if my annotation is present, it will take the annotation. And instead of checking by the name, it will check by the value name on the annotation. So in our case here, this name here we used. So now my example that was previously returning a null, because I was previously only checking by the name and I had no other way of specifying the name, so in this case the names didn't match, then the whole matching algorithm didn't work at all. Now I have another option. I have implemented an annotation where I set the name I expect of the input attribute from where I want to make the copy. And now if I, after my change, run it again, I expect to see again a Tom here instead of the null, even though the names of the fields don't match anymore, because now my algorithm is basically based on the annotation as well. And this is very similar to what happens in Hibernate when you give the name of a table, the name of a column, or when you use the JSON to specify a different name of a node you want to read a specific object from. So the same concept applies in a lot of frameworks. That's why I wanted to show this to you as well, because now you will understand much better what's behind different frameworks that you will use. So perfect. With a little bit of a struggle, of course, on the set there, which we managed to get over, and with managed to see it was a stupid mistake of just reversing the values. I was using first of all the value and then the object instead of the other way around. Everything else that we discussed was lean, and hopefully with this I made myself understood, and that will make things a lot more clear for now when you will find similarities in functionalities, and I'm certain you will find similarities in functionalities in several frameworks. And yeah, that's it, folks. Thank you very much for watching me again. A lot of you have been there again, and you've been very active. And see you next time for next nice examples, depending on, of course, not only what I choose, but also your suggestions. Until then, have a great time for study further. Cheers.